So let we shall start. सहनावतु सहनो भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिः 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 ॐ गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ ॐ शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः ईश्वरगुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेद विभागिने व्यवद्व्यात्तदेहाय श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये नमः ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ So, we shall start the second chapter. We need to keep continue. And sutra number, so we speak last time about the Asmita. We speak about to Asmita. Digdarsana Sankaryu Katma Tiva Asmita. Asmita is the identity as it were of the Purusha with the Buddhi. So today we are going to discuss the sutra number. Sukhanusai Ragaha. Raga. So we have been studying Avidya, Asmita, Ragadvesa, Avinivesa ki Klesaha. So we study Avidya, Asmita, but today we are going to study Raga. According to Patanjali Yoga Sutra, second chapter, Sutra number 7. It says Sukhanu, Sai Ragaha. This is Sukhanu, Sai Ragaha. Sukhanusai Ragaha. Sukhanusai Ragaha. Sukha, the pleasure. Anusai, accompanying. So, Sukhanusai Ragaha. Sukha, the pleasure, accompanying. So, Sukha means pleasure and accompanying means raga. So, Raga is the liking, accompanying the pleasure. Then says Sukhanusai Dvesaha, they try to combine about the commentaries. So you already understand what is a raga. Raga means something, the attachment of the pleasure. That is called raga. So you already understand the meaning, but we shall go through the different perspectives or the commentaries. So according to Vachaspati Mishra, Vachaspati Mishra is the great writer after Patanjali. if you study. So he say that raga means attachment, the sequential attraction to the pleasure. Sukhani say raga, sukhadi, sukha, avi, sukhavigasya, sukhana smriti purvaha, sukhi tattva, sadhane, va yoga gartha smrina, lovasa raga itihi. It's very nice Sanskrit Bachaspati Mishra try to explain. This sukhanusai raga, the desire is possesses, the thrust for and the hankering after pleasure or the means thereof, preceded by the remembrance of the pleasure, is one who has enjoyed, is called attachment. So raga means here who enjoy the that attach, who enjoy the pleasure. They say where the attachment comes, there is certain memory we have, the remember the pleasure of the remember the pleasure of the enjoyments. Where the pleasure, where the enjoyments, there's some part of our consciousness remember, and that consciousness leads to the attachment to that pleasure, and that pleasure they're going to say later also dvesa, the repulsion, but that I'm not going to now. So later we shall speak about raga. Oh yeah, what the attachment comes, where this attachment comes. Because our memory yesterday, the consciousness remember the past pleasure of the enjoyments. And then that enjoyment, that pleasure, the state of the consciousness is going to attach. That is called addictions. That is called raga. So remember, the pleasure is one who has enjoyed. So who enjoyed that pleasure? Jivatma. Our Jivatma enjoy the pleasure. Who remember? Who remember? The mind, a state of the consciousness, either is conscious or unconscious, subconscious. So mind remember that pleasure. And that pleasure leads to the attachment. And if we not get that pleasure, then it became repulsion, became react. It turned to dvesa. So on the attainment of the discriminative knowledge for and the hankering, they say on the attachment of discriminative knowledge is attachment are removed to egoism brought about by nescience avidya is the root of attachment. This is very important on the attainment of the discriminative knowledge. So through discriminative knowledge, through the viveka, the attachment are removed. Through viveka are removed. Egoism brought about by nescience, egoism. The ego leads to the avidya, is the root of attachments. So two things are here. So where the attachment comes? Attachment comes because of ego. Ego is comes, ego brought about avidya. But I mean, already you understood, avidya leads to the ego, and ego leads to the attachment of our pleasure. And when that pleasure is destroyed by someone, then naturally we become repulsion. Dvesa starts. And who is actually enjoy that? Is it enjoyed by Atma? Is it enjoyed by the Paramatma? Or is enjoyed by the Jivatma, or enjoyed by the mind? These questions you have to ask yourself. When we are suffering, when we have difficulties, when we have miseries, then we need to self-analysis, Atma Chintana. Why I'm react? Why I'm angry? Because of attachment and pleasure. And attachment, pleasure, we don't like to give up. And when someone try to make you not happy, then you react naturally, right? When somebody disturb your peace, somebody disturb your happiness, somebody disturb your pleasure, somebody disturb your calmness, and you become react. It means you are attachment of your peace of the mind or calmness or the happiness. These are the difficulties, right? So these are the difficulties to these are the difficulties in order to free from the raga. So when you are raga, you need to have fully contemplate, fully concentrate, fully conscious, and then you have to work out and where am I exactly attached, where am I exactly suffering. So that you have to check yourself, that you have to check yourself. So for this reason, it describes attachment after egoism. Attachment is the sequential attraction to the pleasure. That already you know. So attachment is the sequential attraction to the pleasure. When you are attracted to the pleasure all the time, and that is called attachment. So attachment, the sequence of attraction to the pleasure. When your attraction to the pleasure is known as attachment. So attraction to the pleasure is known as attachment. And addiction of the pleasure is known as dukkha, the sufferings. And we react and dvesa starts. Repulsion starts. The same memory is not possible to one who has not cognized. Hence, is it said in one who has enjoyed. When a pleasure is remembered, attachment is preceded by the remembrance of the pleasure. In the consequence of the enjoyment thereof. When a pleasure is being enjoyed, there is no necessity of the remembrance. They say when pleasure is being enjoyed, whether remember. They say that the attachment, however, to the means thereof, whether remember or actually present, is also preceded by the remembrance of the pleasure. As a matter of the course, when means of pleasure is perceived, it is a remember as a cause of the pleasure of the same class, or it is interfered that it will be caused a pleasure similar to what has been before caused by an object of the same class. The means of pleasure is therefore desire. You say the means of pleasure is a therefore desire. So that means actually he describes the meaning of word attraction. Desire is to possess. So here actually we are the, it's not about the attachment of the pleasure or the attraction to the pleasure. But actually, we create the desire for the pleasure. We are not attraction of the pleasure, right? But we create the desire to have the pleasure. We create a desire to be happy. We create desire to be enjoyed. Then attraction to the pleasure comes. And then attachment comes. So here the desire, the root cause of the desire is the root cause of sufferings. Is it not root cause of the happiness? Is it not root cause of the pleasure? Is the root cause of our desires? Right? So our desires lead to attractions. And attraction leads to the enjoy or fulfillment or pleasures. And most of the time, we actually we can't really enjoy. We can't really experience pleasure. And when you are disturbed of your pleasure, when you are disturbed of your happiness, when you are disturbed by your calmness or quietness, naturally you are angry and repulsion starts. So actually, who want this pleasure? who want this happiness, who want this calmness? That is a question mark today. Who want it? Is it your jivatma want it? Is it your mind want it? Is it your atma want it? It is the God want it? Who wanted it? The question mark here. The question is very simple and answer is very simple. Our mind want calmness. Our jivatma want to calmness or relax or happiness, because our jivatma mind create the desires to have the pleasure, to enjoy. So you already know the atma has no desires, neither pleasure nor unpleasure. Even our atma don't want peace. If your atma don't want happy, and eternal. So atma is remain eternal. Atma is remain calm. Atma is remain peaceful. Atma is remain truthful. Atma is remain love. Atma is eternal consciousness. So no one can disturb to atma. So atma has neither attachment nor detachment, neither raga nor dvesa. So who wanted the peace and happiness? That our mind at jivatma. Right? So when you say that, please do not disturb me, I want peace of my mind. What does that mean? Your jivatma want peace. Your mind want the peace or the happiness. But yourself already in eternal peace, eternal love. Right? So therefore, to be clear that, so jivatma is suffering, not the atma suffering. When you say, I know myself, I actually don't know. If you know yourself, there is no suffering exists at all. Even you don't need peace of the mind. You don't need happiness. You don't need pleasure. You don't need relaxed. Nothing. Because you are, right? You are the relaxed. You are the calm. You are in eternal peace. You are in love. You are in compassion. You are in truthful. And you are in pure consciousness. Am I clear that? So no one can really disturb you. If you know yourself, so therefore here the question mark comes, when a Brahmajnani, Atmajnani, not disturbed by any circumstances, not disturbed by, nobody can disturb their peace and happiness. Nobody disturb their love. Nobody disturb their, to keep continuity their eternal consciousness. Right? So this is about self-inquiry. And you have to really meditate on all about it. You have to meditate. Am I clear? You have to have self-inquiry and meditate properly. Self-inquiry is very important. Meditation is going to help you. The integration of the consciousness, the integration of the higher consciousness. And samadhi is all about to the integration of the Vairava and Shiva consciousness. So therefore, daily meditation is not about rituals, is not about duty, but your regular meditation is helping you how to integrate with higher consciousness. Regular meditation going to help you how to integrate yourself to Atma. The consciousness Atma, the consciousness Shiva, the consciousness of eternal consciousness, the absolute truth, the absolute consciousness. So daily meditation is not about rituals. You can meditate 10 minutes, you can meditate 5 minutes, doesn't matter. But regular meditation has to be done. You can only sit down 5 minutes every day, money time. But you need to have punctual, sincere. Close your eyes and sit down, even 5 minutes. but it has to be very punctual. So since regular meditation is helping you to integrate your yourself higher consciousness, and that consciousness help you to understand your raga and dvesa, that consciousness. So you have to have clear now, atma have no raga na dvesa. Your mind want peace, right? Atma has no stress and strain. So atma don't need peace of the mind. So you need peace for your jivatma. So therefore, check it. Where you have desires, where you have expectations to attraction of that pleasure, to attraction, and that the root cause of our sufferings due to avidya, due to ignorance. So you can actually free from that sufferings by your discriminating knowledge, viveka. So viveka only can help you not to react, not to angry, not to be negative. Right? When you are negative, when you are angry, is all about to your attachment to that pleasure, your attachment to that attraction. We desire it. We create the desire. Right? I tell one thing, a small child sometimes putting the hands on the fire. So the child enjoying it, putting the fire, like the hands moving like that. But the mother is afraid. The mother thinking the child can burn the hand. But the child is enjoying it. Like you see the many children eating a lot of sweets, a lot of sugar, because they enjoy the sugar. So they have the attraction, that pleasure of the sugar. So this is created by the mind. I will be very happy. I'll be in pleasure. Am I clear that? So this makes the attractions to the raga. And sometimes when they don't give you sugar, then you react. So wherever you are become negative, wherever you are angry, there must be raga. Without raga, you never can be angry. You never can react. You never can be negative. That means it disturbed our pleasure. It disturbed our happiness. Generally in society, when are very tough, particularly when running the ashrams or companies, organizations, we sometimes take the proper actions. Why? Because they break the disciplines. Then we can continue our organization forward. Then you are angry. Then you react on the clients, on the workers, the officers. Why? Because the project of the school, the project of the organization, the project of the foundation does not go smoothly forward. That means we want pleasure as well. And similarly, so anyone react on you or angry on you, they are somewhere attachment to that pleasure and you disturb their pleasure. Right? So this you have to be very clear. Am I clear now? And you have to understand this. So raga, you can say that one sentence attachment is a raga. It does not help. It does not help. The teacher has to teach properly. The master. That has to be very clear. Say, and then we are going to sutta number 8. Dukhanusai dvesaha. Repulsion. Dukhanusai dvesaha. They say dukkha, the pain. Then anusai, the second cell, repulsion. Dvesaha, aversion, reaction. This aversion is the sequential repulsion from pain. So what happening? So when somebody disturb you not to enjoy the pleasure, and what do you feel? You feel pain, sufferings, misery. Is somebody not give you chance to have that continuity, that pleasure? Then you become react. When you are meditate in silent, somebody disturb you. So what do you feel? You feel very angry. Don't disturb me. I am in meditation. I am in samadhi. I am in yoga class. So that you react, right? Sometimes your children, sometimes your wife or your family, and you're doing Kriya Yoga Sadhana many times, they disturb you. Sometimes they call you, Papa, there is something happened, water not flowing in the bathroom. And you are in Kriya Yoga meditation. You react sometimes to your children. Sometimes happens like this, so many times happen. So what happening, that is the very important also. When do sadhana, also maintain equanimous of the mind. Is sadhaka need to maintain equanimous of the mind any and all conditions. And that is the real sadhana. Sadhana not your the doing Kriya Yoga, Pranayama, Asana, Mudra, Bandhas and chanting mantras and chanting Bhagavad Gita, Shastras is not sadhana. You can do many hours karma yoga in the ashram. Is not sadhana. He can do study many books. Is not sadhana. He can do mantra chanting. Is not sadhana. And he can meditate many hours. Is not sadhana. If you disturb by anyone. So that means being a sadhaka, being a yoga practitioner, either you are practicing Vedanta, any sadhakas who is to attend the Brahmajnana, Atmajnana, they must maintain the equanimous of the mind every moment, every and all moments in their life. Not only during sadhana for 1 hour, but that is very, very important. And especially when you are sitting in meditation, in samadhi, or doing any kind of sadhana, and you must remember, you're supposed not disturbed by anyone. Even you are meditating your family, or ashram, or monastery, in the cave, anywhere. If you are disturbed by anyone, you are not qualified to do sadhana. You are not qualified to do sadhana. Remember that now? So you check today. Is it I'm ready for sadhana? Right? You have to check yourself. And you are still has no skills to do sadhana. So before sadhana, you must check yourself. Is it I'm ready to do sadhana? Or I simply to listen to the guru and do karma yoga, the seva. So therefore, it's very important. Before we are doing sadhana, you must get the proper guidance of the guru. So that you can get proper blessings or initiation for sadhana. So therefore, it's very important to understand the skills of the sadhaka, becoming a balance of the mind every conditions. Again, I repeat, even do 30 minutes, even do 25 minutes, sadhana, Kriya Yoga, or Pratisasana, Pranayama, even you are sitting in the closed rooms, anybody disturb you, and you must attain with a lovely way, in swift manner, with the balance of the mind. Right? Don't ignore it because you are in samsara and everybody need your help. Right? So therefore, you're supposed not disturbed. You're supposed not disturbed by anyone. And that's the real sadhana. And when you are 1 hour, of course you are in samsara, you're running the company, or a school, many other things, that different things. In the material world, we need someone to take top actions as per needs of the organization and company as well. That different things. Because many people, and for example, you are boss of the company and you must have discipline as well. So everybody break disciplines, you have to take top actions. But with the balance of the mind, with the equanimous of the mind, but especially in sadhana, there, you have to be really very calm and quiet yourself. Be kind to yourself. And you're supposed not disturbed by anyone. and that the real sadhana starts. I see sometimes people disturb, they say, don't disturb me, I'm in sadhana. That is not real sadhana. I saw some people in my own ashram sometime, and I know personally them, they say, don't disturb me, I'm doing sadhana. So what kind of sadhana I do if I'm disturbed? So therefore, you have to be very clear, the skills of the sadhana is to maintain samatma. We say samatma yoga uchyate. What is yoga? To live in equanimous moment to moment, that is called yoga. Samatmam, samatmam, sam means harmony. Equanimous of the mind, balance of the mind, samatmam yoga uchyate. What is yoga? To maintain the balance of the mind, to maintain equanimous of the mind, alive in the harmony. And that is yoga. Yoga is not only attainment of the samadhi, but if not maintain the balance of the equanimous of the mind, there is no dhyana, there is no pratyahar, there is no dharana, there is no samadhi, there is nothing. And there will be nothing. So please note it. Please note it. How we can do sadhana. Very, very important. I remember nowadays when I'm doing the morning time, or a Kriya Upadis, or chanting mantra, somebody come again, Swamiji, and how can, and clean the floor where the key of the main gate, where the vegetables, they ask me like this, you know. So what I mean? I suppose not disturbed by them. That is the real sadhana. Real sadhana. So when I do sadhana, in the morning time in my room, always open the door. So that they can see me what I'm doing. And sometimes they need something. I always say that whatever need, you tell my name. Swamiji, we need this. Then after that go, then I check. It is possible to fulfill or not. So it's very interesting that. So when I actually do sadhana, if you have busy life, you are in samsara, in family life, don't close your doors. Let open the doors. So anyone see you are meditating, so they're not so much disturbed. Sometimes they are curious what you're doing. So let them, if they're, always tell them, if you need anything, you can tell me this. Then I can feel, but I'm conscious, I'm not samadhi and beyond the body. So I can listen. If I need it, I'll come to help you. If I understand, you need it. So therefore, when you live in the family, you have to really balance the mind. Very, very important. Especially the householders is always difficult to do sadhana. As a sannyasin, more easier, maybe in a monastery, maybe in the cave, but as you're leading the life of the family life, you're leading the samsaric life. So that is always most difficult life. But economics of the mind is very important. Either you are a monk, or you are the family man, or you are a businessman, or you are, doesn't matter what kind of persons you are. Either a spiritual or not spiritual. But equanimous of the mind is very important, at least to live in the peace of the mind. And that really brings to the happiness. And nobody can disturb that. So please remember, I repeat again and again and again, and that is very important. When I go to Vipassana study, they always say that maintain the equanimous of the mind. Always remain balance, always maintain the balance of the mind. Bring your awareness on your breath. Always, every moment, maintain and aware the equanimous of the mind. Doesn't matter whatever happening, you may experience either pleasure or unpleasure. Maintain the equanimous of the mind, and that is the meditation. So what I mean, so meditation all about to equanimous of the mind. Therefore in Bhagavad Gita, they say samatvam yoga uchyate. Harmony of the mind is the yoga. Then say, this is dukhanusai dvesaha, dukha avigasya dukhanusmruti, purvayam dukhe tasadhane vayaha. प्रतिदो मत्तियोर जिज्ञासा क्रोधस द्वेषः. सो दिस इज संस्कृत दैट ट्राई टू स्पीक. द रिपल्सन इज द एंग्जाइटी. सो रिपल्सन व्हेन यू रिएक्ट नेगेटिवली वी आर सो मच डिस्टर्ब आवरसेल्फ एक्चुअली इट इज द एंग्जाइटी. वी आर डिस्टर्ब. द विश फॉर रिमूवल एंड द एंगर एंड द पेन एंड द मीन्स देयर ऑफ व्हिच स्टिक इन द माइंड इन कॉन्सिक्वेंस ऑफ द फीलिंग ऑफ पेन. So when you are feeling so much pain, what happened? So much anger starts. So you are before addiction of the pleasure, and when you react and you are not enjoying that pleasure anymore, that convert to pain, that pain convert to anger. And what happened that? You see, in the case of him who has felt the pain preceded by a remembrance of the pain, is aversion. You say, Vesa is nothing but experience of the pain. And that comes repulsion, reaction by the anger. So anger naturally comes. So Vesa is nothing but anger. But that anger leads to all the way to suffering more and more and more and more. So therefore, what to do? This is Bachaspati Mishra explained. Aversion, the sequential repulsion from pain. So whatever you are suffering, and so suffering is the root cause of our vesa, the repulsion, the anger. So why are you supposed to angry? Because we feel pain. No more pleasure anymore. So pain is the root cause of our anger. Then after that I say, one who has felt pain, this is to be explained as before. Describes the meaning of the word sequential repulsion from pain. The repulsion. Repulsion is the force which repels, amplifies the same by the stating synonymous, the anxiety. So here they say that repulsion is nothing but anxiety. So all kind of anxiety is called leads to the repulsion, dvesa, and also leads to the anger, also pain. So anxiety is something which is also cause of avidya, cause of asmita as well. You are studied already, avidya, asmita, raga. So avidya also, avidya and asmita both, and that called raga, and then leads to the dvesa, the repulsion. So, attachment of the, then here what happening? We don't want pain. We want attachment of the pleasure. So when we try to react on the pain, that leads to anger and anger and anger. And that anger all the way leads to the pleasure. And then you are entered into again avidya. And again enter into asmita. Again, enter to raga also. So therefore, one should have the discipline, knowledge, the viveka, in order to remove either raga or the dvesa. So awakening of the viveka is going to great help in order to sort out of your all difficulties and the obstacles. Then, we are already speaking avidya asmita raga desa avinivesa. Now I'm going to sutra number avinivesa. Let complete today. Sutra number 9. Then I tried to little bit also before going to avinivesa. Later we shall go little bit another commentary. This is whenever there is an object of pleasure and the mind runs after it, we seem to have the pleasurable experience again and again. This is called raga. This is not very difficult to eliminate. One can eliminate it from one's personality with a little jerk, given either by the nature or created by one's own self. Dvesa is the opposite of the raga. Both of them bind innumerable persons and things. either positively or negatively. They are definite conditions of our mind, and that conditioning is done on the basis of a sense of happiness or the repulsion. So most of the time, we do two things. Sometimes we experience pain, but we are still continuing. Even pain is there, but unconsciously we don't understand its pain. And we take as a pleasure. I just give one example. When a dog, I saw our dog one time, or many times I saw sometimes, there's one is they killing the animals outside. This one is bring the bone. And they're eating the bone, the dog. So when I see the dog, they have so addiction to the pleasure of the meat. And they're holding the piece of the bone. And they try to eat the bone, right? And after that, what happening, after certain times, because there's so much addiction to that pleasure, they forget even there is pain also, but they forget that pain. Even blood coming in the mouth. There are all teeth, blood's coming. Because when blood coming, there is pain. But what happened? The addiction of so much pleasure there, they forget the pain even there. Pain is there. And here they don't react to the pain, but rather their attraction of the pleasure. Eh? Sometimes the attraction of the pleasure, maybe a dog have positive for the pleasure, but in negative actions, what is that? If the only blood comes, pain is there. So similarly, in our life, we have addiction of the pleasure, but sometimes we are really suffering and suffering and suffering. And sometimes it does go to unconscious and suffering, like cancer. If anyone is suffering cancer, they don't know. They don't know. Cancer is like a dog. Like a dog eating the bone for the pleasure. But the pain is there because the blood coming through the side of the teeth. You understand? The cancer patients are like this. They are somewhere. They have attachment of the pleasure. That pleasure leads to the depressions. That pleasure leads to depressions. And they don't notice the depression. After that, what happened? That changed to actually cancer and cancer. Like I say that, a dog don't notice the pain. The blood coming, there is pain, but they don't notice it. It's unconscious. Right? Similarly, we have so much pain in our life, so much pain and suffering, but still you are unconscious. But after a certain time, and when these teeth have so much blood, so much pain comes, then dog, they try to not eat the bone. But that is too extreme. And that is our human life. So we have so much addiction of the pleasure, we forget. And we are harming ourselves. We forget. We lose ourselves. We forget. We are already disturbed. That anxiety comes unconsciously. That is called dvesa. When you realize, it's called dvesa. Am I clear that? Many cancer patients, people, they never notice, they never aware there is cancer. And you can check that. Many people have been shocked. Is it have the cancer? Am I clear for you this sentence? Many people have cancer, they don't notice any cancer, they don't notice it actually. Because of addiction or the pleasures. And that leads to raga. And unconsciously, there is already dvesa, they're already repulsion, but they don't react, they react, but unconsciously, like a dog, maybe react blood coming, they don't notice. But body, the jivatma, naturally will react if there is pain. But sometimes you don't notice the pain. I give one example. If you're drinking alcohol or smoking the cigarettes, any kind of smokes, what happening? Your lungs are damaging, liver is damaging. But you have so much addiction to the pleasure and you forget the pain of the livers and the lungs. And so there is the pain. And there the liver pains and your lungs have problems and even already contaminated to be cancer, but you don't notice it. You don't notice actually. Because of addiction of the pleasure. Right? And we have no conscience about our own pain. So yoga teaching you how to experience and both. So as a yogi, if there is pleasure, you must be aware. And that pleasure supposed not lead to the raga, not to attachment, not to make you sufferings. Then naturally, there will be no dvesa, no repulsions. And you are becoming a yogi. So that means you are maintaining the harmony, equanimous of the mind, the both happiness and sorrowness. The time of difficulties, the time of happiness, you must maintain both. Raga and dvesa bind us down to the lower levels of the consciousness. All kind of raga and dvesa is released to the muladhara and swadhisthana. So long as they are there, the mind cannot be raised to the spiritual heights. So if I have always raga and dvesa, it's very difficult to rise our consciousness to the higher consciousness. It should be remembered that they are the two sides of the same coin. They are the twofold expression of an inner raga. Liking for one thing involves repulsion for something else. So they are not the opposite of the each other, but are the two ties, two sides of the mind. Dvesa should be removed first, and then raga will also go natural. So that means we have to, it's not attachment that has the big problem to you remove or be free. The thing is, we suppose not react. That is very important. Yardsticks. Well, therefore, when you do sadhana, somebody disturb, you suppose not react. You suppose not disturb by anyone. And that moment, you need to balance equanimous of the mind so that you not disturb by anyone. That is called reaction, dvesa. And that you have to compare very beginning. So naturally, you can free from the raga, naturally. So very important not to react negatively, angrily. So that helps you to free from all kind of raga, attachments. So there will be no sufferings at all. No misery. Then you are the real good sadhaka. To do any sadhana, to any meditation, whatever you do, any kriyas, tantra, mantra, chakra, whatever, then naturally you can attain the Brahming and Atmajnana, then be free yourself. And that the true love. It is dvesa which is more powerful binding force. It is a great hindrance. When dvesa is removed, meditation becomes deeper, and then raga can be given up. It is said that a man is affected more by dvesa than by raga. Therefore, one should get rid of hate. So it's very important. So tomorrow I'll speak of Abhinivesa, only raga is completed today. So therefore, we have to be very clear how to free from dvesa, the repulsion. So therefore, it's very important not to react. Anytime anything people say, that time if anyone anything to say, always say like my guru. If I ask anything to him, he always say, let me think about it. Let me think. And he never give answer straight. He always think, if I give answer straight, maybe it's negative, maybe positive, maybe something. So he always let think about it. Anyone, like if you're a company manager, you must not take the decisions rightly and immediately. No. You must take decision, take some time. Like you see, many judgments in the world, like judge in the courts, they never take decision that day. It takes some long time. 1 year, 2 years, 10 years, 40 years, 50 years. Why? Because judgment need to write decisions. Write decisions needs the time. Calm and quiet mind. Equanimous of the mind. Balance of the mind. Not to react. Not quickly react. So therefore, same time, you have to judge yourself. Take the judgment of yourself. To viveka, to discriminate knowledge. And once you are free from the ways of the repulsion, so natural raga is removed and you are able to qualify it to do any sadhana and meditation and leads to the attainment of the Atmajnana and Brahmajnana. Then you are free yourself and then you are enter into eternal peace, eternal happiness, eternal love and compassion, and experience the higher truth, the higher consciousness. Then your life in the samsara, although you carry this jivatma, this physical body, and you can be happy and peaceful, and nobody can disturb that happiness and peace of your mind. So be wise, awakening the viveka, lead free from dvesa and raga, and lead, meditate, and realize the higher self. So now 2 minutes, if you have any questions, please. Mariana, any questions? Any questions now?
Yeah, I have two different versions of Doga Sutras, and then the one for Raga. It's just we were talking a lot about attachment, and in the other book it's just called liking, and there's no comment. Just liking. And in the other book, it's attachment. And today we were talking long time about attachment and why detachment, how detachment, and how to free from detachment. And so, and the other book was, so it's also based on the Sanskrit words, how to translate the Sanskrit words.
Actually, every author's whatever they write is according to their state of the consciousness, but as a master, as a guru, and you have to actually to think about it. You suppose not read only books. You have to find out the proper way to explain your own students as the present moment needed. As we are here in this platform, so what exactly today and now we need it, and how to explain. So this is the qualification of the masters. The satisfaction of the student, the qualification of the masters. It does mean all book have the proper knowledge. No. Book is the infinite knowledge, the intellectual knowledge of someone. But same time, we can read, we can take reference, but we have to use our viveka again, and discover knowledge, our own viveka. That viveka, and through viveka, you can explain to your own students how, or your own disciples, how is the applied, how is the implemented. So therefore, otherwise everybody can read the books, they can understand everything. So why today we need masters and gurus? Even lot of information coming YouTube, in the books, but there is no feedback. There is no input. Who can have the input? You can read the digitals. You can go to the... So why need physical masters to study this? So still we need always master to explain you properly. We have to respect the whatever the books and sastras. We have to respect. But that is not enough to read only to understand. I also could read the books. Why I need to spend my time in traditional monastery? Why I need to leave the home and come to Himalaya? Why I need to go to the guru to study all these things? I could read the books as well. No. So the bookish knowledge doesn't help us to understand properly. Not understand properly. So therefore, always remember, if you study sastras, if you study any kind of spiritual science, you have to have study under guidance, the masters and gurus and acharyas, not normal teachers. But where you have love and dedications, there you can study. Intellectual, don't study. It does not help you. Because there is no love, there is no kindness, there is no respect. So anyone teach you anything from books, it does not help you. And sometimes you read the books, many books out of intellect. Actually, you don't have a proper... kind of love to that person. We don't know that person. We don't have proper devotions. We only want to read intellectual way many books. Even you don't know who is the writer, who is the these things. Right? So therefore, we have to study everything with the master and the gurus, where you have love and trust. That is very important. Any scriptures to study with any masters and acharyas, you must have love and dedications and the positive efforts and trust. If you only want to study out of curiosity, with any master, with any book, it does not help. It does not help for your knowledge or wisdom. No. Only curious, it does not help. Because curiosity is also leads to the negative. Sometimes you compare, oh, this book write like this is not good. This book write like this is not good. So you have curious. And we are also curious ourselves. So curiosity is not good. So we have desire to know the truth. We have desire to know the real wisdom of that sutras, of the sastras. So therefore, in ancient time, all kind of sastras one has to study with the master, with the gurus, with the humbleness, with the dedications, with the trust and belief as well, and with the positive efforts as well. Am I clear? Like sometimes you study college and university, it does not help nothing. It does not help for our spiritual growth and to be sadhana. It does not help. And you can read, you can go to many YouTube and many other things. It does not also help for temporarily. So it's very important to study with the physical masters and gurus. And otherwise, you need nothing. And simply sit down, close your eyes and meditate every day without any scriptures. That's the best way. That's the best way. Like Ramana Maharshi, he went to Arunachal, Tamil Nadu. He always self-encouraged. He not been in school and college and university or any gurus to study all scriptures. No. He simply sit down and he meditate and he simply surrender to Lord Shiva, Arunachal Shiva, and have self-enquiry. And all knowledge he have. It doesn't mean knowledge is within books. No. I already said that is an imperfect knowledge. Knowledge, real knowledge, is comes when once you attain Dhatmajnana, Brahmajnana by the meditation. Am I clear that? So thank you. So let we shall go. Purnamada. Everything is absolute. The absolute merge in absolute. And absolute coming from absolute and remain absolute. Eternal coming from eternal. And eternal coming from eternal. Eternal merge in eternal. And everything is eternal. Very interesting. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shantihi Shantihi Shantihi. Lokaha Samastaha Sukhino bhavantu, lokaha samastaha sukhino bhavantu, lokaha samastaha sukhino bhavantu. Om shantihi, shantihi, shantihi. Sankaram Sankaracharyam Kesavam Vadarayanam Sutramasakritau Vande Bhagavanto punaha punaha. Iswara guru atmete murti veda vibhagine vyavavadvata dehaya siddhachina murtaye namaha. Om shante shante shante. Sivoham 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 Sivoham, 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 Sivoham. Om Gungurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. So, thanks to all of you. And may Lord Shiva bless you all. And may Patanjali receive. Bless you all to enter in the kingdom of the eternal peace, led free from all raga and dvesa. Om, 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 om.